Good evening. Welcome to the 100% Spa Show. You're in tune to slrradio.co.uk with Star, Buzzing Bee and Jammers. Yeah, we're all over the place today, I have to tell you. Listeners, we've been off the air for so long, we're actually learning how to walk again. It's been a little bit of a challenge. It's always a bit of a challenge for me where it comes to the technical aspect. And Jammers has kindly come into the studio to assist me as Buzzing Bee, for those of you who don't know, has got a little bit of a war injury at the moment and unable to walk about, even though I'm sure he's walking about still anyway. But he shouldn't be. But you are in tune to the 100% Spa Show on slrradio.co.uk, live and direct. And today we are celebrating everything Jamaica, honouring the Independence Day for Jamaica. That's 56 years of Jamaican independence. We're going to talk about, has independence benefited the country? We want to hear from you. We also want to anybody to send out best wishes, a congratulations. We want you to tell us what you are doing to celebrate this wonderful Jamaican 56 years of independence. And we're going to talk about obviously famous and known Jamaicans and just the profile of Jamaica, because it is still without a doubt, if anybody says they come from the Caribbean, the first thing they say is it Jamaica? You know, sometimes you don't actually believe there are other islands there, but because of the history and the world stage that Jamaica sits on, that's what we're going to be talking about.
And I'd like to thank you for inviting me down.
Oh, you thank you for saving me. I mean, you're more than welcome inviting you down. Actually, you've I welcome you because you know you're really yourself and Freddie. I've got to thank Freddie as well. Have given me a lesson in how to set up. And I have to be honest with you, I have no excuse. I'm not a feminist in any way. But you know what? I should really need to know how to do this. I mean, I'm not going to go as far as changing my own tyres on the car or anything like that. But this, I'm going to make an effort.
Once you know how to do it, it's once you've been shown, you know.
Yeah.
Sometimes we don't want to reveal too much.
Well, it's not so much revealing. I don't mind if I can't do something. I'm happy to say I can't do it. That doesn't bother me. But what I have to do is learn. So we're going to have a quick track. After the track, we're asking you to please join the debate, 07984 931 588. We want you to text us, send us an email, sparshow100@gmail.com. text us, even call us, and tell us what you are doing today celebrating the Jamaican independence, and what it means to you.
And if it's the first time you've listened in, this is the 100% Spa Show with your host Star, and I'm standing in for Buzzy B. And what we do, we discuss tropical issues, all kinds of issues. We have topical discussions and
aims and objectives,
and we have a proper reasoning. It's not arguments. We need to know your solutions and your formulas, not just blaming and shaming. Here it's called the Spa Show because we mentally stimulate your mind to a higher level, so it turns up the heat in your speaking.
I love that. There you go. I'm going to use that tagline.
And also, we've got another guest. Is it before the music? So, Theo, could you introduce yourself as well? Because you're full of theories and practical solutions to the spa.
Well, I've been away for a while, actually. So, once upon a time, I was kind of quite irregular here. So, it's good to be back. It's good to be back in the studio again. Shout out to Buzzing Bee. I hope he's actually, you know, paying attention to his advisors and convalescing and, you know, in a relaxed kind of mode. Jamaji almost did all of the introductions for me, but yeah, I'll be contributing where I can.
Thank you very much. So, also, we've got another Bajan guest sitting in the studio. My friend Cheryl is here from Barbados, and she's been spending some time in London town. Do you want to say a quick hello to the listeners, Cher?
Hi everyone, I'm Cheryl. I'm from Barbados. I hope to be able to hear you and that you call in with your different discussions. so that I can understand what's going on. Thank you.
Okay. So there's Cheryl giving us a shout out from Barbados. And it'd be great because we can get your concept living in the Caribbean about independence, really. We know recently Barbados has had a new government in place. So let's just pick up on something Jamma's just said. And I'm just going to quickly go through the aims and objectives of the 100% Spa show because they are really important. First of all, people always say, why the 100% Spa show? And I just want to remind people that the SPA stands for Special Personal Attention, because our show is all about you, and yes, you, whether the radio is murmuring in the background. And the areas we cover, we look at love and romance, because love really makes the world go round. We look at home, health, finance and fitness. When we look at home, we talk about not home in the sense of just buying a property. It's like, how is your family life? We look at your health, and that's not only your physical health. We also talk about your financial health, because that's important. We look at fitness, family, friends, rest, relaxation, money, spirituality and religion. And then we have a topic for the day, which is something that's usually in the background, or we bring it to the forefront, or it could be just about anything. We take contributions from our listeners, because the show would not be a show without you. But more importantly, as Jamma said, we like to hear solutions to challenges that we face, because when it's all, if we speak honestly from the heart, we all face challenges at some stage, and we'd like to discuss that. So that's what we're about. But we're going to have a first track very quickly. This is Jamma's. We're going to have track number one. Welcome back to the 100% Spa Show. You're in tune to slrradio.co.uk with Star, Jamma's, stepping in for Buzzing Bee, Theo, and Cheryl, a studio guest. And we are absolutely enjoying this hot weather, but it is exceptionally hot, everybody, isn't it? I mean, what can we say? We moan about the weather. The British weather has taken a whole new topic now. Wouldn't you say, Jamma's?
I think it's actually celebrating Jamaican independence by the weather that we're getting here. So we're in line with what's happening with our fellows in the Caribbean. You know, and I just like to say that Jamaican independence didn't start with the act, it started with the actual people. It's the essence of the people that everything that they do, food, music, talk, walk, you know, they don't conform, you know. You know, so it's the spirit of the person that's led to this independency, not the act.
They're right, and I think that's really fitting, because the Evening Standard actually covered a bit about the celebrating the Jamaican independence, which is today the 6th of August. And it says Jamaica has been a British colony since 1655 and eventually became the hub of sugar production during the slave trade. Now, after the Act of Emancipation, it went into effect in 1834, one of the colonial government's main form of control over newly freed slaves was through a carefully constructed education system, was meant to prepare them for employment as estate workers. Now, during the 1930s, Jamaica experienced an economic depression, which led to the labour riots over working conditions, which were appalling, really, absolutely, you know, and people were not prepared to put up with that. In 1938, Norman Manley formed the People's National Party and would later become Jamaica's first Prime Minister. In 1961, a referendum was called to determine whether or not the people of Jamaica should remain part of the Federation, and the Jamaican people voted for independence on August the 6th, 1962. Now, the British flag was lowered to make way for a new Jamaican flag, and it's really interesting because they've actually given a little bit about what is the meaning of the flag, and I'm going to share this because it's literally picks up from what Jamma's just said. The meaning of the flag. So, the Jamaican flag is black and green with a yellow cross. The sun shineth, the land is green, and the people are strong and creative, is the thinking behind the flag symbolism. The black represents the strength and creativity of the people, Gold signifies natural wealth and the beauty of sunlight, whilst green symbolizes agricultural research, resources and hope. And that's not only hope for the people, it really is about the contribution, as Jamis just said, that Jamaican people have made all over the world. Now, we've recently know about the, and I'm going to bring it up because we're going to talk a little bit about that. We know about the recent Windrush scandal, and we can't move away from that because the first ship obviously contained Empire Windrush. The most people on board were from Jamaica, seeking another life in 1948, people continuing to make a difference. But why this 19 in the 16th century, where they talk about 1655, Britain, Jamaica being a British colony? I want to talk about Queen Nana of the Maroons, because I don't think that enough consideration people realize that Queen Nana, in, you know, who was born 1686 to 1755, she is a Jamaican national hero as a woman. And if we think about the fight that she put up to fight the establishment at those times, for the Jamaican Maroons, you know, to win a settlement of over 500 acres for Maroon, you know, for people to have their own town, Moon Town, Nanny Town, and later Moore Town in Portland, Jamaica. If we just think about the mindset, the strength, the organisation and the tenacity of Nanny of the Maroons, is someone I believe that we should be celebrating, not only in Jamaica, but through the whole of the Caribbean, as a woman who, as they say, came from the Ashanti tribe, who refused to be a slave, who fought, and technically won. Gained her freedom, gained her town, gained her right and gained her dignity for people who were enslaved. So that's who I'm honouring. I'm honouring all the Jamaicans, but that is definitely about a shout, my hero.
Yeah, Theo, you'd like to comment on what's just been said, or you've got your personal equations that you'd like to stimulate the discussion with? I'd just like to say that Jamaica is the origination of so many interesting things. Jamaica produces the Blue Mountain coffee, a highly sought after and expensive coffee that is popular across the globe. It's one of the rarest coffees in the world. In 1988, Jamaica was the first tropical country to send a bobsleighing team to the Winter Olympics. Jamaica is home to over 200 species of exotic orchids, 73 of which are indigenous, with only three winners, there should really be more, and three runners-up in the Miss World competition. Jamaica truly does boast some of the most beautiful women in the world.
I'm sure everyone's saying they're here into that, aren't they? 07985 07984 93 1588, you know, they've got some handsome looking men as well.
Also, in relation to music, which people might not be aware of, Kool Herc, a Jamaican, is responsible for the starting of rap and hip-hop music. See, so basically they try, it looks, people look at America to hip-hop, but it's actually a Jamaican who, see, when it comes to music now, Jamaica has such a powerful, they say reggae, but Jamaica has such a powerful in even how the music is produced today, from the toasting, from the vibes in there. If you hear like they're using dancehall beats, mm-hmm. in Ed Sheeran is using dancehall beats in the
Definitely,
music now.
He is.
So the it can't be underestimated, the contribution that Jamaica makes, not just in terms of music, but in terms of the way people even dress, you know, the way people, even in sports, look at the Usain Bolt, you know, they've changed the parameters of what excellence is.
Yeah, they've taken it to a whole new level. And I think what you've just said there, so what you've just said there about the music and the beats, does this always go back to the fact that people are not truly credited for they're not recognised actually as being the innovators or the mother of certain things, because what, because it's an island, just an island, or because it's better that it says it comes from America? What do you think?
There's a whole, I think Phil would go into this a lot more, but there's a whole aspect of the mindset of somebody who takes something from somebody else and doesn't give credit to where they've taken it from. You know, the root word of that in Latin is alien. Alien, really, is not something that comes from extraterrestrial being. In the middle of the word alien is the word lie.
That's what I was about to say.
The root word of alien is somebody who comes in, takes somebody else's thing as their own. And that's really the essence of what happens in the mind concept of the person who does that.
That's really interesting what you said, and why that's got my mind ticking there. I'm just thinking, when the US are talking about the aliens, you know, when you arrive on US soil, mm-hmm. they say, are you an alien or a national, you know? And what you've just said there, mm-hmm. I think is really got me thinking.
Because another thing is, they're not ashamed to say it, because when you come over here, you're classed as an illegal alien if you haven't got your paperwork in order. Mm-hmm. So that means they must be legal aliens who take people's things from somewhere else and have the right to copy it.
That's right. You know. Well, would that apply to something like the royal family that have all the jewels of Africa and all the other things? Would they be... Where would that sit?
Well, it seems to be a common mindset. Fia, would you like to... interject in this or add to that? Basically, there is a big, when it comes to recognition, you know, the especially like the contributions that we make to society. Even if you're looking at the Windrush, look at what's happened to our parents and forebears who came here.
People, yeah.
You know, so when we do contribute to society, you know, it's just written off. You know,
it's not recognized. It's
not recognized, and it seems like it's a problem to recognize what somebody else has done for you.
I agree, and not accepting that. And I think it is very disingenuous, and actually, as I say, I always say very rude, because you can't deny the fact that you've done something. The fact you're not acknowledging it doesn't mean that you have not made the contribution. But you are in tune to the 100% Spa Show on slrradio.co.uk with Star, Buzzing Bee, listening in, Theo, and Jammers. all there. I'm so used to just saying BB, right? My studio husband, that we've got Jammers and Theo in the studio, and we are honouring looking at the independence for Jamaica today, 56 years of independence, and just talking about the contribution that Jamaican people have made to the world. And I say the world because everywhere on the planet knows Bob Marley. I'm giving that as an example. And also just talking about Nanny of the Maroons, who in the 16th century, she was born in the 16th, 17th century, who actually fought the colonial masters for freedom and won, and demanded land for the Maroons of Jamaica, which they were successful. So the mindset of the individuals is, if we look at the colours of the flag, where they talk about unity and about strength of the people, it truly is important.
Yeah, I just wanted to pick up on the point you said about all of the things that you all, yourself and Jammers, have already mentioned previously, and you said, you know, about them introducing all these things to the world, and it goes way beyond Bob Marley, as I'm sure you'd agree. And then it also have to take in consideration the many things that, as you've lot just mentioned, they've not been credited for. So that strength, all of those attributes that make Jamaica what it is about more or less unearthing all of these misconceptions about the people and the Caribbean in general, and those contributions that still are being, other people are claiming credit for. So it's an ongoing story that needs to be told about what Jamaica has done, what they have achieved, the history of creativity, of resistance, all of those things that makes it the unique place that it is. And this is just a part of that acknowledgement. So, and it has to always be continued as more and more information comes to light that can exonerate Jamaica in a certain way from some of the negative stigmas that's been attached to it.
But when you say exonerate, that's a really interesting word you use there. So do we think that there is kind of...
Could I just stop you there? Because it's the spa show and he's used a word that's it's making my brain overheat. So could you break down that word, please? Because this is called the spa show.
Okay, we're called the spa show. Special personal attention.
It's not food for thought, it's banquets for thought.
Okay.
And banquets come with a certain
amount. So we're feasting, are we?
Okay. We're feasting on Sophia. Can you break down this word? Is it exonerate?
Well, I don't know the roots of the word exonerate, but I'll just give you a kind of quick and dirty definitive terms of reference. Exoneration is actually the when one is vindicated of previous crime, for example. You know, when you've been falsely represented, when you've been slandered or libeled, the exoneration is the truth coming to light that, you know, is liberating for that person, their image, and those like them. So that's a more or less a brief kind of roundabout introduction, or if you want to, the whole idea of exoneration.
Okay, you are in tune to the 100% Spa Show on slrradio.co.uk with Star, Jamis, Theo and Shoal in the studio, having some cherries.
And Buzzy B watching and over as the media.
He's hovering over the whole
buzzing
era.
Around still.
Hovering over the whole era. And we're just talking today, we're just highlighting and celebrating the Jamaican independence today, 56 years of independence, and talking about where Jamaica stands today on a global scale, the fight that individuals have made to have Jamaica recognised. And as Theo just said, he used the word exoneration that Jam has picked up on to say that the rightful recognition of the contributions that people of Jamaican heritage have made is not always accepted, respected and acknowledged, and it's something that needs to change.
And I want to take up what you said about the recognition. There's a problem with them recognizing, because when they start to recognize the contribution of not only Jamaica but what us as people have, then they might have to recognize that certain items that they have in the museums or wearing on their crown, where they've come, and have to return them back to their rightful owners. I believe you've got
an article here. It's so funny you should mention that, Jammers, because a couple of weeks ago in the Evening Standard there was a little story that said the plundered treasures could go back to Ethiopia. And as we know, Ethiopia is now got a new person in place. There's no longer war between the Eritreans and Ethiopia, and there's a very positive movement taking place in that part of Africa. And it says treasures including a gold crown and chalice looted during a British invasion of Ethiopia in 1868 could be returned to the African nation. It has campaigned for the return of the plundered goods since it was seized after the siege of Emperor Tewodwo's fortress. And it says that when the country was called Abyssinia, some of the items will be shown in an exhibition at the Victorian Albert Museum marking the 150th anniversary of the battle. And it says, speaking ahead of the show's opening at the Victorian Albert Museum, Tristram Hunt, I think he was culture at the time, said he would be ready to assist if the Ethiopia wanted a long-term loan of the treasures and other valuable loots from the country, and said to be in the British Museum. So what they're basically saying, the Victorian Albert Museum has an exhibition, they're going to show them, but they're happy to talk to the Ethiopian people if they want to loan their goods. This goes back to what you just said, doesn't it?
So I mean, it's really ridiculous, because the British Museum really is just showing stolen goods, really. You know,
that's
stolen
right.
goods, and they're still getting wealth because they're paying people coming to watch and visit the goods that they've stolen from. You
that's
know,
right.
from us. And I mean, if one item was taken from them and taken away, you'd see that they'd go to war over it.
Of course, they'd go for war over nothing.
And then there's another whole dynamics on identity. Because basically, if you're not giving a person recognition, you're not giving the cultural, the people who from that race and other places, a purpose of the identity to have an awareness of where they've come from and how the skills that they've got. And there's a disassociation because they're, you know, renaming everybody and separating everybody to say that we all come from different places. But if a pigeon flies from one place to another, it's still a pigeon.
That's right, doesn't change.
You know, as soon as you start putting a label on people who've come from one common place, mm-hmm. then we don't associate with the skills, or we separate the fight that they've had. We now become like isolated.
Disenfranchised as well.
Disenfranchised and cut off from our real potential and the direction of who we are and what we need to do.
No, you're right. So, Jamis, based on what you've just said there, looking at this story, I'm sure there's going to be quite a few people would agree that we all know about the theft of the artifacts. I mean, the list goes on, so we're not going to we're going to labour that. But what I wanted to ask you, if we think about the Caribbean overall and Jamaica, do you think that the individuals in Jamaica can relate to Africa? Just wanted to find, because I do find sometimes there is this disconnect with people that still do not want to acknowledge, you know, that they are of African heritage. And I think that's all the way through the Caribbean. I don't necessarily just think that's Jamaica. I'm just wondering, we know everything going on now with the Windrush and people not being acknowledged. Do you think that there's more, they've heightened the aspect that their roots could lie in Africa? I mean, if we look at the Honourable Marcus Garvey, we have to honour him as well, because he's, you know, we had his day, the Liberation Day, the other day. That was the whole message. But I'm wondering, has that message got lost in, I won't say translation, I would say, has that message got lost in the Atlantic somewhere?
Well, I think the problem is there's no, you'd have to really integrate to actually really appreciate, you know, the cultures that have been separated through this transition, through especially through slavery, because my mum was Jamaican, my dad was South African.
Really?
Yeah, so I can fully experience the difference that there's that sort of animosity between the two races in certain aspects, like, I don't know, there's a feeling amongst I don't know, that the Africans, that they don't fully integrate with the Jamaicans in a certain way. They're a bit wary of the way that they are, because there's a cultural difference in way, food, behavior, mannerisms, and you can sense that there's a kind of animosity as a, when you go as a Jamaican into an African. I think the Jamaican are more, they're a more welcoming set of people. They're more welcome through what they've experienced. They have a more friendly persona about them. But then they can sense the weariness of the African around them. And then that brings up them to be defensive. So there is a kind of dynamic amongst the Jamaicans and the Africans. On a general basis, but when there's proper integration, like from Jamaicans going into Africa or Africa coming to Jamaica, especially with our young ones integrating in the music and in the culture, then there's a coming together. But it's not straightforward as you can say, oh, we come from the same place.
So that's what I was about to say. Yeah. So is there still an identity? I won't say a lack of identity, because I'm quite interested to hear you say that you are, we don't like using labels, like you quite rightly said, but if we're not ticking boxes, but you are technically a real African Caribbean, because if one of your parents is from, in fact, there's no box for you, actually.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, I don't fit in the category. I come out of the water, really.
Well, there's okay. But it's interesting. Mm-hmm. So growing up, listening to what you've just said, do you think that was that obvious to your parents, that they, you know, the cultures were different?
Funny enough, with my parents, there was no difference amongst them. I don't know, the dynamic with them, you know, there was just blended in as one.
Yeah,
you couldn't feel any difference between the two.
Mm.
You know, the only thing is my mum, I had more culture from my mum because the cooking and that. My dad didn't really maintain his African language and stuff in a certain way.
Oh.
You know, so it's more, I had more the Jamaican influence. But I'll say that we're both at an identity crisis, because from time you as a Jamaican don't really recognize yourself as African, and from time you as an African don't really recognize the Jamaican as an African.
That's right.
We're both in a identity crisis.
Absolutely, you know, that is so true. 07-984-931-588. Give us a call and let us hear your thoughts. Jamis has made some really good points here. We're talking about identity, and if we all come from Mother Africa, Why is it that some of us live in, I would say in the diaspora, not only in the Caribbean, do not recognize that is our place of origin? I think it is a problem for lots of reasons, because if we speak to individuals that are from Asia, they recognize their roots. And the same goes for other races. But we do seem to have a challenge along those lines. We do. But Theo?
Yeah, in an attempt to answer some of that question, because I'm wary about when we should be, you know, celebrating Jamaica, then kind of like lingering on things that are not quite so encouraging to speak about. But I'll just try and get through it quickly. I mean, it seems completely unrelated, but there's a point to it in that. A US sitcom by the name of Blackish had one of its episodes shelved and cancelled for being to go on the air, because the whole story was that the father of the family was left at home with the youngest child and had trouble getting them to sleep, so he decided to tell a story. But the story wasn't one of these, you know, once upon a time there was a girl in them. It was a story about the history of African people and African Americans in general, and he was going through various kind of like political and cultural stepping stones to where they are now. And apparently one of the things that he was going to touch on was that Colin Kaepernick take a knee thing. So it was withdrawn because they felt that this episode would just kind of stir up too much political, you know, unrest. But what I thought was that they saw something else in there. I mean, I didn't see the episode, I just heard about it, and I thought, you see, where it relates to what we're talking about is that in that there was a lot of symbolism there which I think they would not have liked to go out over the airways. One was that you had a father with his child, and he was passing on information through stories. We have an oral tradition amongst us. It was also about who is first to the socialization of our children's minds. All of that was going to be laid out in this apparent sitcom. Now, I could see where they didn't want that, and I could see how that relates to the way in which we identify and relate with one another. It's about who socializes your mind first and foremost, and how you actually kind of like interrogate those identities that are instilled within you, what they represent, the implications of those, and how that has you behave. And all of that is balled up in this idea of recognizing our Africanness, recognizing our solidarity as one people, even though dispersed around, and all of that, and Jamaica, and the Maroons, and all of those things that all the people we've spoken about so far, in their own way, represent what needs to be done to bring all of that back in, to actually heal those rifts. So that's what makes it all important, that those things are recognized.
And what it is, we have to really understand or understand all of this, that all these different labels that are attached to us at different parts of the country, it's all aspects of us. So when Jamaica celebrate, we've got to celebrate as a Jamaican. When Ghana celebrates, we've got to celebrate as a Ghanaian. When Nigeria celebrates, we've got to celebrate, because this is all aspects that we've kind of lost of ourselves that have been put out. You know, so this is how we should be coming together and use it. Saying independence, we really need to be interdependent among each other to bring back our full identity.
Okay, Jamas, have we got some texts in that there? Can you check? I can see the phone's got some things going on there. So, Buzzing B, you're not here, so he's passing it to me. Okay, so
I'm not familiar. So, is Buzzy B usually reads out the texts?
Buzzy B usually does everything, right?
Oh, right, okay.
Okay. So it says we've got a text here from 006. Hi, 100% Spa Show. All sounding good. Liking Jammer's voice. Yummy, yummy.
Oh wow!
Looks like you've got a fan there. Looks like you've got a fan there, Jammer's.
Wow.
That's what it says. Loving Jammer's voice. Yummy, yummy. That's right. You have got kind of a nice voice, actually.
I'm learning from Theo with that bass line. He's my new vocal coach.
So keep your there's some more there, but I'm not sure how I view them. But if you'd like to keep your texts coming, we welcome them. Literally, so it's 07-984-931-588. You can text us or you can call us. We're also said when we opened the show, if you want to send a big hi to anybody, celebrating the Jamaica Independence Day today, please do. If you'd like to call and tell us what you're doing, you may be at home just having a few rums and listening to some music and just feeling the love. We want to hear from you. And you want to join the debate, please do. We welcome that.
And once again, just like to stress that it's called 100% Spa Show because it's not a normal just blaming and shaming. I had a discussion with Buzzy B, who was kind of briefing me in this, that basically, you know, we try to show you the how to reason in a constructive manner. When you reason, and what they make us do is keep looking at history. When you keep looking back, you keep blaming and shaming. You know, proper reasoning is you look back at the past, you take the stage, the moment where you're at the present, and then you work towards the future. I believe we've got a caller coming through. Let me see.
Okay, we're gonna try. Good evening.
You just cut him off.
Oh, it did work. Can you try a call? I'm so sorry. Can you try again? Because the phone's here, should work, but we just haven't got the magic touch. He's there. Go on then. Good. I'm touching it. Go on, sweetie, try Theo. Good evening. Oh, good. Good evening. Welcome to the 100% Spa Show.
Keep talking while we kind of try to establish the levels.
Okay.
So if you keep talking,
I don't know about that one.
Where
good
I'm
evening.
Actually
welcome
trying
to the 100% Spa Show.
Reconcile this issue right
Hello.
Now. In the meantime, while Jammers is saying that, I believe it's our fearless leader Buzzin B who's trying to make some contributed remarks right now. Now, when it comes to this this association with do we have him back now?
Hello.
Are you there?
Can you guys hear me?
Yeah,
we can
hear you.
Oh, good, because I've been just... Okay, then.
Well done. Good evening. Welcome to the show.
Yes, Buzzin. Yes, how are you doing?
Yes, Buzzin, I'm calling in.
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay. I just wanted to...
That's good.
First of all, we've got you guys, Star, Jammers and Theo. I've been listening to the discussion. First of all, on the Ethiopia situation, the Jamaica independence, and of course, people who don't want to associate with their with the Africanness or the fact that they're of African descent. And what I want to say on the situation to do with the African is that I think, as we are all aware, that has been a running theme in amongst our people probably for the last 400 years or more. Some people would argue longer. Because it's quite interesting that you're having that discussion, because on the 1st of August, which is Emancipation Day, and that is celebrated in the Caribbean in particular, to do with the Africans freeing themselves of European rule, and particularly in the English side of things. And I want a clip coming from a news media house in Barbados, and the Minister of Culture, I think, and Communications, he was laying a wreath at the statue of Bassa, who was one who led a slave rebellion in Barbados in 1860. So he's commemorated there on the 1st of August, which is Emancipation Day. But what he was saying was that a lot of Barbadian people of African descent seems not to want to embrace their Africanness or who they are. And he was quite sided them in terms of the small turnout that came to pay respects to those who fought so gallantly in order that they should be free. So he made a point of it, and he's also a Pan-Africanist. I probably to say that the first Pan-Africanist in the cabinet, I suppose, as things go down there. But he actually made a point of it, and seemed rather disappointed that people of African descent didn't seem, to want to embrace their heritage or their Africanness. So it kind of speaks to what you spoke about as well. So that's the point that I wanted to comment.
That's really interesting. So, Cousin B, so do you think that as Jammers was sharing with us, it's not a conscious thing? It's sort of come about because of the divide and the disconnect that continues to pursue, because people keep putting labels on somebody. Oh, you're from the Caribbean, you're from America, you're from England, you know. But it's not a case of your root is from. I suppose culture is different. Jammer's made a good point that growing up, one member's family came from Africa and the other one came from the Caribbean. So maybe there's a cultural difference, but at the heart of it, you know, we are all the same people.
I think it would be foolhardy to deny the nuances of that, of the culture or the cultures from which we came. Yeah, I don't think that no one should even deny that when people talk about this oneness. They still have to recognize that people come from a slightly different cultural orientation, even within that big continent that is Africa, and even us who spread to the Caribbean. I think we have to also recognize those psychological differences in the way that we perceive ourselves. But that doesn't mean either that you have to necessarily deny who you are. I suppose that we, in Jammer's case, where you have parents from both Africa and the Caribbean, I think there can be a middle ground there, because essentially Africa is the heart of it, really. So I think that there can be a common ground can be found between the two, since that one culture emerged from the other and vice versa. So I think if there's a willingness on that person's part, I suppose that there can be a connection. As a matter of fact, they should be able to connect to both, depending on the kind of environment that they came up in. So I don't think that should be much of a challenge in that respect.
Okay, thank you so much, Buzzing B. Theo, did you want to add some comments to what Buzzing B just said?
Yeah, I was trying to... Can you hear me? Am I being heard here? Right, so what I was thinking, I'm not sure if it's directly, what I was thinking about is the case of the whole Ethiopian crown debt.
Yes, that's right. They said they could loan them to them.
Well, yeah, it just made me think that this just represents an entirely consistent attitude right across the board. It's just about everything. So everything that we're acknowledging that Jamaica done and others are these situations where, you know, if it applies to artifacts, if it applies to culture, if it applies to resource, then there's this consistent pattern of taking and then setting the conditions to whether you get it back or loaned back to it. But see, the important thing is that the one thing that they can't take and give back are our identities, our truth, history, our sense of who we are. They can't give it back to us. We've got to give it back to ourselves.
So
and this is part of the process of doing that. Acknowledging each other singularly, but then also recognizing the collective will and the collective goal. And that's how I see it in that respect. So we need not complain too much about their attitude to us, because, I mean, they're not going to change.
No.
It's we who have.
Absolutely.
So it's about time for some Sanko for it. You know, he's a return.
Lovely. That's really well spoken there, actually, Theo. That's really true. Okay, Buzzing B. Do you
All right. I'm gonna go up the line and listen to the rest of the show. Just keep up the good work, in the studio, and I shall listen to the rest of the show offline.
Thank you so much. There's Buzzing B making a contribution. I can see, but Jammers, you've got to make a move now, haven't you? So you can relate to Buzzy B the same.
Because I see, especially as I was living in the middle ground, I didn't see anything different between Jamaica or Africa. It's just like, it's just a personality. So basically, a member in your family's got a funny way that they laugh. Another member in your family's got a funny way that they dress. They're still the same family. You see, what this society has done is made the laugh more important than the family, or made the dress sense more important. Mm. So it's like we're more looking at the differences.
The exterior.
Exterior, rather than what we have together. And that's the whole illusion that we've been put under, you know, that when they've got a problem, they can see themselves, they can unite as an Australian, as a British.
Absolutely.
Or whatever.
It doesn't come into it,
you know, but it's like we've been trained to look at a difference and celebrate that as our uniqueness, when our uniqueness is what we have together.
Definitely,
yeah.
That's so true.
Well, I've enjoyed.
Thank you so much for coming in.
Buzzy B hasn't sacked me, so hopefully I'll be back next week.
No. Yeah, well, you're not going to be sacked at all. Definitely. Thank you so much. That's really great, powerful comments that you've put into the show. And we know that we are celebrating not only Emancipation Day, but we're talking on a wider level. It's not just about one day for 56 years celebrating Jamaica. We're actually talking about Nanny of the Maroons, who fought for freedom at a time when, you know, 1600s, 1700s, it was unheard of, you know. But there's somebody saying, I refuse to be a slave to anybody, okay, let alone you, and fighting for the cause. And it just shows that it can be done. And we have to truly start accepting that we are standing on some very broad shoulders, and we need to stand up straight and get on with it.
And I think the key is if we're not celebrating somebody else, we're celebrating the qualities that we have.
Mm.
It's the qualities that's been in our past that we have together. It's called memory. Me, Maori. Maori means your menelin, your black nature. The old word Maori from the Moors as well. So when they say memory, it's uniting what you have. Like you might see, like a new child is born and they're dancing like the grandma, you know, or they're dancing
right.
like the old uncle.
Yes,
so basically,
right.
the spirit of the past is what we have in us, and it's celebrations like this unites us to see who we really are and our possibilities and capabilities as a people.
That's so true. Thank you so much. Before you go, I did pick up a little article in The Voice, actually, last week's Voice, and believe it or not, they've said 10,000 want to be Jamaican citizens, and apparently there's been an upsurge with Jamaican passport. Immigration and Citizenship Agency has reported an increase in applications for citizenship. The agency received more than 10,000 applications in 10 years, and the largest category for people of Jamaica descent, followed by requests from Cuba, North America, the UK, Costa Rica, and Panama. So it seems a lot of people are recognising the importance of having the true status and identity, and there seems to be a surge of people wanting to become Jamaican citizens.
And when you look at the Windrush situation, it's are you really wanted here? That's the next.
I think
problem.
This is what we this you is know, what we're going to spend the next
really
couple of minutes talking about.
You look at society now. You look at how it's developed, especially for our young ones, and it's all about machines now. You know, the bus drivers, bus is going to, you know, we've got a supermarket. There's no people anymore.
No.
You know, factories no more.
No.
Shop, it's all online.
Well, that's what they've said. The internet is the fourth industrial revolution, and that's a fact. And they've actually said automation and things like that are going to make certain roles, they're going to disappear literally. They're going to be no need for certain skill sets, and that's happening slowly but surely.
And then when you look at the buildings that have been built around you, you know, they're too expensive. They're not for us.
No.
You know, they're out of our expense.
No.
So it's for incorporating another set of people in here. And just like how they've experimented with rats, and then when you bring a certain amount of rats in, you can eliminate and exterminate a situation. You have to wonder what is really
going
on. Are we really needed here? And maybe this is why we should be going back to where we, you know.
Well, we should be looking at alternatives.
Alternatives, that's
whatever
it. Yeah.
Whatever we feel. Thanks. But I think the alternatives is definitely important. You know, there's no ifs or buts about that. We have to look at where else can we live and live peaceably, because that's what you want. You want to have peace of mind that you're somewhere you're respected and you're not going to get a knock on the door after 50 years. You're going to knock on the door after 50 years and someone sort of saying to you, you don't have the right to be here. So we do have to look at that. And I think the yes, please, the Marcus Garvey mission was all about that. And it's interesting how, I'm not saying how seriously we take that. I think we people do take it a lot, very, very seriously. But there does appear to be a movement of individuals who are, thanks, Jam, nice to speak to you, a movement of individuals who are making their way back to Africa in some shape, form or fashion, and building their houses, relocating their families, and doing very well. I know there's a big movement to the Gambia that's taking place, and I believe the same for Ghana. So I do think things are happening.
Yeah, I mean, going back to that whole thing, yeah, whether, I mean, what I was thinking really was the point about whether we're really wanted here. I think really the crux of the matter is that we never really were in the first place. There was a situation in which they'd brought about certain circumstances on themselves and left them in a predicament which then required, you know, people to come up and clean up after them.
That's so right. That, help us rebuild that, after the
of
war.
Course, that was the situation that was always, you know, supposed to remain, and of course it didn't. You see, you know, I mean, and you know, it relates back to the very same things we're talking about when we're recognizing Jamaica's independence and you're recognizing the creativity of the people. And even despite you, you know, subjecting those of our parents' generation to such, you know, inhuman, you have to say it, kind of conditions and circumstances, there was still thriving activity.
Absolutely.
And you see, this is what led. So that very same attitude that was there came here, which is why we had these riots. It wasn't just, you know,
no.
It wasn't just people
disgruntled
and having chips on their shoulders and stuff. There was genuine, mm-hmm. you know, provocations that led to these kinds of outcomes.
That's right.
You see, and I'm saying all of that because, you know, we have to kind of like, you know, steer the firearm in the face. You know, we have to look down these two barrels and see what the situation actually is, you know. And so all kind of things followed after that, i.e. things like race relations acts and
which came quite late,
like that.
Didn't that really?
But you see, you know, the thing about it is that you have to question exactly what even, because all race relations is, when we get down to the you know, the nuts and bolts of it all, was just oppression management. Yeah, that's all it comes down to. It just comes down to how are we going to manage our rule over these people we didn't want here in the first place.
That's right.
What minor concessions do we make whilst
what can we get away with?
Exactly. Whilst remaining, you know, keeping them, you know, pretty much, you know, in control. So that's always been the case, and it's just morphed and developed into other such types of, you know, what people like to call initiatives and legislation and statutes. But the fundamental mentality, the fundamental attitude as we see, still hasn't changed.
It doesn't. And I think that what you've just said there, Theo, I do have to pick up on, because the whole Windrush story, we now understand that the Windrush victims are being gagged to have their claims fast-tracked. But the rule is, yes, we will fast-track your claim, but you are not allowed to disclose anything about how much money you receive, how you received it, or anything. They've actually insisting that there's a gagging order in place, and that goes back to what you have just mentioned, that how can we keep these people, you know, I won't say mummified, but the truth of the matter is, after such a scandal, they shouldn't be talking about a gagging order. They should be talking about exposing that and talking about how it happened, why it happened, and how it's never going to happen again, let alone trying to tell people, well, you know, we've treated you really badly, but now there's going to be a non-disclosure agreements in return for fast-track compensation. Now, I'm wondering, if I'm somebody who you've actually picked me up, you've put me in deportation centre, I have every right to be here, you've treated me very badly, you're now telling me, all right, you can kind of stay because we're allowing you to stay, but you will receive compensation, but with a non-disclosure agreement. I just think that is the height of... I'm really lost for words now. Seriously.
There's many events that are going on outside of the public domain when it comes to, you know, this issue. Even though these reports are appearing in the mainstream media, you know, they're still heavily edited. The narrative still has to be kind of controlled in a certain way. There's such a thing as... It's in journalism. I think it's a D order.
I don't know.
I might be wrong. Someone out there who's listening might correct me on this.
Please,
but
there are certain
aspects in journalism where the government will actually prohibit them from reporting on certain issues point blank. So there's only a certain amount of information that's actually going to reach the public domain anyway, even in cases such as this. The other aspect of this, of course, is going back to what I said, is that, you see, this doesn't just highlight the actions of the government. This highlights the actions of those in these internment...
Absolutely. Situations and positions.
It also highlights the behaviour of... because there was something... It didn't involve the Widnush generation and those who were affected by this, but it also looks at the whole immigration issue where you had employers who would be doing certain things such as inviting immigration to their places of work and then telling the staff that there's an open training day.
And
they would turn up for this open training day and get carted off.
That's right.
Right? You know?
Yeah.
And all of this highlights the mentality of
a
vast amount of people.
Well, it is really evil, but this story is from The Independent 2 days ago, and it says the Home Office is gagging victims of the Windrush scandal in return for fast-track compensation, sparking accusations that Sadiq Javid, who is now the new Home Secretary, has broken a promise to MPs. A non-disclosure agreement has been imposed on at least one person who suffered harm, and at least one more has been approached, The Independent has been told. Now, the move comes despite the Home Secretary telling MPs 3 weeks ago no one will be asked to sign any kind of non-closure agreement or anything like that. The gagging, a tactic normally used by celebrities to hide embarrassment, was condemned as totally unacceptable by David Lammy, who is the MP for Tottenham and was actually one of the MPs that really spearheaded the whole Windrush situation. He is a Labour MP and a Windrush campaigner. And he called on Mr. Javid to explain why he had apparently gone back on his word. And Yvette Cooper, the head of the Commons Home Affairs Committee, said she was extremely concerned, adding, using NDAs to hide things that have gone wrong cannot be justified. The Law Society meanwhile warned that anyone who tried to reach an agreement with the Home Office without independent legal advice could be denied justice. Now, the controversy has blown up after Mr. Javid was criticised for slamming the brakes on an official scheme to compensate members of the Windrush generation and for planning to cap their payments. So this is really interesting, he says, and no decision on how it will work will be taken until the end of the year, despite warning that people have been left destitute after losing their jobs, their benefits and even their homes, or being wrongly detained. They were trapped by Theresa May's hostile environment crackdown, unable to provide the correct documents to employees, landlords and the NHS, acting as de facto border guards. But Mr. Javid has now revealed the Home Office is prepared to pay out immediate compensation if threatened with possible legal action and accepted it's culpable. Now, if we look at this just so far, Theo, what you've just said, first and foremost, you do a total injustice. They talk about Theresa May's hostile environment. The hostile environment meant certain people, we've seen the stories, and actually, do you know what? There's probably a lot more out there we'll never see. But we've seen some of them. People have lost their homes, they've lost their family. One gentleman even lost his life. I saw the mother on television crying, you know. It's very sad. I mean, it's very upsetting as well. But I think we actually covered this on our show. We said, why are they setting up a commission to talk about what went wrong? A situation like that, that's not a time to be setting up a committee. You should be making sure all the as many individuals who have been affected by your hostile government are compensated immediately. You should be throwing money at that. If that's what it takes at that stage, that should happen. But when you talk about we're asking people to ring a hotline and talk about their sorrows and what happened before we talk about compensation, that leads me to think you don't want to pay anybody any compensation. You don't want to pay anybody compensation because that's not the right way to tackle it. Because you have to justify how much you're suffering. They're asking people to put a price on how much they suffered. And I think under the circumstances, that should not be a question. They should have compensated those people and their families immediately. There's no two ways about that. And I've said this before, and I will say it again. I know that people think, oh, whatever. But we have to remember, 1948, when the individuals came from the Windrush, not too long before that, we had the Kinder children that came. The British government called a meeting. They went and they saved those children from the gas chambers in Germany. They brought them here for safety and they looked after them. And that is the right thing to do. All the children that arrived in the UK were given £50 money to try and obviously find their families so they can reconnect again. And they helped them to settle in. All the right thing to do. So why is it that you have another set of people that have come along at the invitation of the same government, a couple of years later, done their contribution, but they don't want to have no recognition of their contribution? I just find it, I can't honestly find the words for it. It's beyond, it's like, why do they think it's going to go away? It's just madness. There's no way they can deny the contribution of the people, of our people. How can they deny it? And then to ask people, you've thrown someone in a detention centre, they've lost their home, one person was had prostate cancer, was died. I mean, the list goes on, and they're not talking about a non-disclosure. NDAs, people talk about celebrities, NDAs are mainly in place for business transactions. That's really where the NDAs come in. So that means they continue to see our people as a business, this whole thing as a business transaction.